Good evening and welcome. My name is Jo and I am the Area Dean for Nottingham South. That's St Mary's sits in, and it is my absolute delight to welcome you all this evening for Rob's licensing to this this place and this parish and these people. Particular welcome to friends and family of Rob, some of whom have travelled, I don't know how many miles, some miles, I guess, to be here tonight. You are especially welcome. We are thrilled to see what God might do in this next chapter that Rob is going to turn the page on in St Mary's. I hope you've all got a copy of the service sheets. If you haven't, please indicate to the stewards at the back. And the service would just follow through all the words you'll need. Are contained here. All the words, all the prayers, everything you might need is contained in here. I will draw your attention to the back because the retiring fund, there's a very clever gizmo on the back, the QR code, and this is for the Bishop's discretionary fund. So all the offering tonight will go to that. Can I also say that in true hospitable style, St. Mary's have laid on a feast of, I'm not sure what, I guess there might be cake involved in the church hall, and you are all invited to stay once the service is finished to join us to continue to celebrate this special day in the life of St. Mary's Church. So would you stand as you are able, please, as we begin our first hymn this evening.
Stop. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Welcome. Please do take a seat. I'm Bishop Andy, Bishop of Sherwood, and it's an absolute delight for me to be here this evening at St. Mary's at Woolerton Park to license and install Rob as priest in charge. And welcome to Rob and Alison, the family. So good to have you all with us here this evening. And thank you for coming, clergy in the sort of deanery, people from the local community, local councillors, other church leaders. It's so good to be here celebrating together this new phase, what we hope and pray will be a wonderful new phase in the life and ministry of St. Mary's Woolerton Park. And also welcome to Graham Archer, who's a patron, representing the patron CPAS this evening. Graham, thank you for being with us. There will be lots of opportunities for us to pray for Rob this evening at this key moment in his ministry and in the ministry of this church. But could I encourage you all, us all, as we go through the service, to be praying for him, for the family, for them to settle really well, and for the Lord to be at work in this ministry here in this church. So let's have a moment of quiet, and then we'll share this opening prayer together. God, our Father, Lord of all the world, we thank you that through your Son and called us into the fellowship of your universal church. Hear our prayer for your faithful people, that in their vocation and ministry, each may be an instrument of your love, and give to your servant Rob the needful gifts of grace, through our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Bishop, I present to you Robert David Brewis to be admitted to the cure of souls of this benefice.
Thank you, Archdeacon. Registrar.
The Church of England is part of the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, worshipping the one true God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It professes the faith uniquely revealed in the Holy Scriptures and set forth in the Catholic creeds, which faith the Church is called upon to proclaim afresh in each generation. Led by the Holy Spirit, it has borne witness to Christian truth in its historic formularies, the 39 Articles of Religion, the Book of Common Prayer, and the ordering of bishops, priests, and deacons. In the declaration you are about to make, will you affirm your loyalty to this inheritance of faith as your inspiration and guidance under God in bringing the grace and truth of Christ to this generation and making him known to those in your care?
I, Robert David Brewis, do so affirm and accordingly declare my belief in the faith which is revealed in the Holy Scriptures and set forth in the Catholic creeds, and to which the historic formulas of the Church of England bear witness, and in public prayer and administration of the sacraments, I will use only the forms of service authorised or allowed by council. I swear by Almighty God that I will pay true and canonical obedience to the Lord Bishop of Southwell and Nottingham and his successors, in all things lawful and honest, so help me God.
Thank you. We're now going to sign the declarations. We're now going to have our readings.
The first reading this evening is from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 15, verses 50 to 58. You can find it there in the service sheet. I tell you this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, "Death is swallowed up in victory." O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. This is the word of the Lord.
Please do stand if you're able as we sing together.
Chained by the power of your word, revive us.
Sit for our second reading.
Our second reading may be found in John's Gospel, chapter 2, beginning to read at verse 1. On the third day, there was a wedding at Cana in Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus also was invited to the wedding with his disciples. When the wine ran out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." Jesus said to her, "Woman, why dost thou have, what has that to do with me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now there were 6 stone water jars there for the Jewish rite of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water." And they filled them up to the brim. And he said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the master of the feast." So they took it. When the master of the feast tasted the water, now become wine, he did not know where it had come from, though the servants had drawn the water new. The master of the feast called the bridegroom, and he said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first, and when the people have drunk freely, then the poor wine. But you have kept the good wine until now." This is the first of his signs Jesus did at Cana in Galilee, and manifest his glory, and his disciples believed in him. This is the word of the Lord.
Shall we pray? Father, thank you for your word. And we pray, Lord, that you might write it on our hearts and it might make a difference in our lives. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 58. "Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain." Well, Rob and Alison, the family, Nicholas, Anastasia, Isabel, Sebastian, it's wonderful, as I've already said, to have you here at St. Mary's. We're delighted that you've been willing to answer God's call on your lives and come and serve here. And having met you during the discernment process, I know something of your passion for gospel, for the gospel, and for gospel ministry. Your desire, as Paul describes it here, to give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord. And as you know, and as the PCC knows, we have some reasonably high expectations for what the work of the Lord may be here in the coming months and years at St. Mary's. The vision is to grow the church, both spiritually and numerically, to lay the foundations for long-term financial stability and sustainability. And in particular, I think one of the aims is to try and double the size of the current congregation to around 100 adults over the next 3 years, to connect with students, with young adults, with young families, to provide suitable evangelistic opportunities, to deepen people's discipleship, to release lay leaders, to increase giving, both the numbers of givers and the level of giving. I mean, I could go on. But it's no small task that we've set ourselves here, you and the church. And as you and I know, and this is the good news, yes, we are called to give ourselves fully to this work, but, and it's a big but, what we are giving ourselves fully to, according to Paul, is the work of the Lord. Unless the Lord is involved, we're not going to have any chance of seeing any of those visions, those hopes and dreams become reality. Now, of course, it's not all going to be straightforward. I can almost assure you of that right now. In the church in Corinth, I mean, Paul wasn't having a straightforward time. Quarrels, factions, one-upmanship, sexual immorality, lawsuits, failure to acknowledge the poor, to treat them equally, disorderly worship. I mean, St. Mary's is going to be a breeze compared to Corinth, isn't it? I hope so, at least. But there will be plenty of challenges along the way if we're going to nurture growth, both spiritually and numerically, in our church. And so it will be important for you and others to heed Paul's call here. What is his call? To stand firm, to not be swayed, to let nothing move you. To remain steadfast. And if that's going to be possible, then we have to have the right foundations in place in our lives and for our ministry. Now, what might those foundations be? Well, first, grace is inexhaustible. That's the first foundation. God's grace is inexhaustible. John's Gospel, John 2, verse 7. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water." So they filled them to the brim. Jesus and his disciples have been invited to the wedding at Cana. And as I'm sure you're aware, in the Middle Eastern culture, celebrations would have gone on, those sorts of celebrations would have gone on for a few days. And in a context where hospitality was highly valued, disaster is about to strike. The host is going to be shamed and embarrassed. They've run out of wine. And nearby are six stone jars, which we're told the Jews used for ceremonial washing. Big jars, large jars. Each would have held the equivalent of 80 to 120 litres of water. And as we've heard, they're filled to the brim. And Jesus takes all that water and turns it into wine. Lots of water turned into lots of wine. It's an act of grace. It's a sign of astonishing extravagance. And only a very few in the story are aware that it's even happened, that anything out of the ordinary has occurred. This sign points to something of the abundance, of the extravagance of the kingdom of God, of the remarkable depths of the grace that we can experience in relationship with Jesus Christ. We have a shelf in our kitchen cupboard at home, and it's known as the treats shelf. It's a shelf where we keep packets of biscuits, chocolates, sweets. My wife and I have three teenagers. We don't quite have four, but we've got three children, three teenagers, two boys and a girl, aged 16, 14, and 12. And one thing they do is they take a little snack with them to school each day. And I usually put three of their favorite biscuits in a little Tupperware container for each of them. And normally, that shelf is pretty well stocked. But there was one occasion recently where it had been just a very busy week, and Liz and I hadn't quite managed to keep on top of the shopping as normal. And by Wednesday, the shelf was looking pretty bare. The choice of snacks was pretty meager, and some concern was being expressed by the children that we were going to run out of food before the end of the week. Now, on the Thursday morning, we were down having breakfast, and Sebastian, it's a great name, by the way, I have a Sebastian as well, Sebastian, my middle boy, my 14-year-old, he mentioned that he'd had a dream during the night. Now, I don't think I can ever remember him talking about his dreams before. But his dream had been that he'd come down in the morning to find that the treat shelf in the cupboard was completely full. overladen with snacks and chocolates and biscuits. And in the dream, I'd allowed him to take a whole packet of biscuits to school with him. Well, wishful thinking, of course. We laughed a lot. It was a brilliant dream. And of course, it's something of a picture of the gospel, of inexhaustible grace, of shelves overflowing with goodies. What Paul describes in 1 Corinthians 15 as death being swallowed up in victory, the good news of the gospel. The difference that the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead makes in our lives and in the world. Abundant snacks on the shelf, whole packets of biscuits to take to school with you, water turned into wine, the wedding party in full swing. This first foundation for ministry. God's grace is inexhaustible. The second foundation, faith changes everything. John 2, verse 5. His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you. Do whatever he tells you." Now, I'm not sure it can have been easy being Jesus' mother, given some of the things that he got up to. And yet here, when the problem arises, Mary models something of what I think faith looks like, of what it is to put our trust fully in Christ. Do whatever he tells you. And that same trust is shown by the servants. They fill the jars to the brim. They take the cup to the master of the banquet. They trust Jesus. They do what he asks, no matter how counterintuitive it seems. Now, one of the benefits of living in Nottinghamshire is that there is some great countryside to explore, and we've tried to get out and about as a family since we've been here. I've been here just over 2 years now. And one weekend, I decided that as a family, we would cycle from Southall to Oxton and back. Now, for those of you that know that, well, it looks a straightforward, pretty straightforward loop on Google Maps. Not too long, not too tricky. But what I hadn't done, of course, was check out the terrain. I hadn't realized that we would have to cycle up Oxton Hill. And not just once, but twice from two different sides because of this circular route. I wasn't popular with the family, I can assure you. My three teenagers made their feelings very clear halfway through this bike ride. They were not impressed. Now, I'm reasonably fit, but I'm not a regular cyclist. I don't have a very good road bike. And I did get most of the way up Oxton Hill. I tried pretty hard. But at one point, I realized I just couldn't keep going. My legs were exhausted. I had to admit defeat short of the summit. And spiritually, that's a little picture, if you like, of what I think at times we need to be willing to do. It's okay to get off the bike, to admit that we don't have all the answers ourselves, that we can't do it all in our own strength, that we won't necessarily have all the resources. Instead, we're to put our trust in the one who does. We're to put our trust in Jesus, to have faith in him, to do what he tells us, to admit we need help to get to the top of the hill. As Paul puts it in 1 Corinthians 15, the sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. So, Rob, As you start out in this new ministry here at St. Mary's, two foundations that I want to encourage you to pursue and for you to encourage the church to pursue. Grace is inexhaustible, and faith changes everything. Remember to put your trust in Christ. And one final reflection from John 2. The master of the banquet, the chief steward, he loves the wine. So much so that he takes the bridegroom to one side. Everyone brings out the choice wine first and then the cheaper wine after the guests have had too much to drink. But you have saved the best till now. The best is yet to come. That's what we believe about the kingdom of God, that his purposes will prevail. As I've said, it wasn't easy. I needed help. But I did eventually get to the top of Oxton Hill. And cycling down the other side, well, that was the fun bit. Momentum, energy, exhilaration, joy. And that is what life in Christ can be like. So stand firm, Rob. Let nothing move you. And the best is yet to come. Amen.
Dearly beloved in the Lord, the declaration of assent, the oaths of allegiance to His Majesty the King, and the oaths of canonical obedience to the bishop having been taken and subscribed before us as the law requires, we propose now in the name of God and in the presence of this congregation to license to the benefice of Woolerton Park our well-beloved in Christ Robert, and we ask you to join together with us in prayer to Almighty God that he would grant to his servant grace to perform his solemn duties aright.
Andrew, by divine permission, Bishop of Sherwood, under the authority of the Right Reverend Father in God, Paul, by divine permission, Lord Bishop of Sutherland, Nottingham, to our well-beloved in Christ, Robert David Brewis, Clerk, greeting. Whereas the benefice of Woolerton Park within our diocese and jurisdiction now stands vacant, we do hereby grant you license and authority to serve as priest in charge of the said benefice and to perform all ecclesiastical duties belonging to that office under the provisions of the Ecclesiastical Offices Terms of Service Measure 2009. And so we commend you to Almighty God, humbly praying in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ through the Holy Spirit that his blessing may rest upon you and your work. In testimony of which, we have set our hand and caused the episcopal seal of the Lord Bishop of Sutherland, Nottingham, to be affixed this 29th day of January in the year of our Lord 2023 and in the 8th year of his translation.
Receive the cure of souls, which is both yours and mine. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. The God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the eternal covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever. Amen.
Having admitted Rob to the cure of souls in this parish, I charge and require you, Archdeacon Phil, to install him into this church and benefice.
By this act, Rob, I install you as the parish priest in the congregation of Christ in this benefice. May you fulfill well the ministry you have received from the Lord. See that you lead your people in the way of holiness and faithful service of God our Father, after the pattern of our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
I present to you Rob as your new priest in charge. Remember that you share with him in the ministry to which he has been called. For as St. Peter wrote to all Christians, you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people. Many congratulations. We welcome Rob. And now we are going to have some welcomes, and Elaine is going to introduce those for us. Thank you.
Well, my first... yeah. Oh, we've lost one. Two. Well, my first great pleasure and duty is to welcome you and your wife and the whole family to the Deanery of Nottingham South and to this area generally. You'll have to pass this on to your mum, all right, when she comes back, because I know you said it was probably hard for Mary to be the mother of Jesus, but to be honest, I think it's the hard to be the mother of anybody, especially when they're two. Anyway, welcome, and if you do need any help putting the chain back on your bike when you're nearing the top, just give us a shout and we'll do our best to help. So we've got one or two people just to invite out to give their own welcome, and I'm going to start with the Reverend Graham Archer, who is representing CPAS, the patron.
Welcome. It's great to see you here at the end of this process. I know it's been a long wait for the parish, but we're really delighted that you're here. I represent the patron, CPAS, and you'll discover that we don't just sort of get involved in trying to help find the vicar. We do pray and support you on the journey, and you'll be very much in our prayers in the coming weeks. But welcome to you, welcome to the family. Really excited for you.
And next I'm going to invite David Gibson up. He's the warden of this parish.
It's a great pleasure, Rob, to welcome you this evening to what I will trust in the Lord will be many, many years of faithful service amongst us. And in the name of Jesus, you come to a wonderful part of Nottingham, a very important part of Nottingham, I think, with the university and the Queen's Medical Center, and busy roads leading to all sorts of places. So we pray for God to bless your ministry amongst us in many ways. And give our greetings, please, to Alison and your lovely children. I think Nicholas might learn the organ or the piano or something, you know. Great. Thank you very much, then.
And next I'd like to invite our City Councillor, Nottingham City Councillor, Pavlos Kotsonis.
Hello everyone, my name is Pavlos Kotsonis and I'm one of the councillors in Lenton Wollaton East. So on behalf of the political leadership and on behalf of Nottingham City Council, I would like to welcome Reverend Rob Brewis in our community. Faith leaders offer a much-needed moral guidance and support for all our communities. They also enhance community cohesion and understanding between all residents. The universal message of Christianity is one of love of one's neighbor. It's one of hope. It's one of peace for all people, all of which are very much needed, especially at a time like the one we live now. I would like thus to extend my best wishes to Reverend Brewis, for assuming his position in our community today to help deliver those messages. And I'm sure that he will perform his duties well. Once again, welcome.
Now, the next gentleman sounds like a very useful contact. I'm going to invite Gary Bevan to come up. He's the post office manager at Farndon Green, the chair of the local residents, and I'm told he knows everyone.
Hello, good evening and welcome. Welcome to this wonderful area of Wollaton Park. And like I say, I'm Gary Bevan, the manager of the post office just down the road, and I'm the chair of the Wollaton Park Residents Association. So welcome to the area and welcome to your family.
Thank you.
And finally, we have Richard Hopkin, Senior Pastor at Emmanuel Church, Bramcote.
Welcome, Rob. I think I've also been asked because I am the Chair of the Midlands Gospel Partnership, of which St Mary's Wollaton Park is a partner. Quick flash, we exist to see healthy local churches in every Midlands community. We've got a strap line and I've learnt it, but we're really looking forward to working with you in the years ahead, Rob.
Each of our intercessions were inspired by the songs we've been singing in our service and what Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. At the end of each part of our prayers, I will say, Lord, in your mercy, and if you can respond with the words in bold type, hear our prayer. Let's pray. In Christ alone, my hope is found, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. Gracious God, thank you for giving us your Son, for sure and certain hope in him, for a rock of life now and forever, whatever the drought or storm. Thank you that by the apostolic message of Christ we are saved and have a firm place to stand. Help us to stand on it, to hold firmly to the gospel you revealed to the Apostle Paul for our salvation and security. Thank you that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried and raised on the third day according to your promises. Thank you that trusting in that message we have not believed in vain. Keep us firm in your rescue. Keep us repentant for sin. Keep us in the faith of the scriptures, our rock and our redeemer. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we come to you now, trusting again in your power. Almighty Father, thank you that you have unlimited power to do anything your will desires. We ask you, Father, to revive us in our day according to your will of grace, to deepen our conviction of sin, to give us a profound delight in Christ, his person and work, to make us more profoundly alive by your Spirit, that we might be through him renewed inwardly day by day as we await his final resurrection and the transformation of our bodies. Please give us to know Christ in us more and more by the Spirit, to live in his empowering presence, that all of us, healthy or sick, strong or weak, might find true strength in Jesus our Lord, who lives with us now and will raise us with him at the final day. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Facing a task unfinished that drives us to our knees, Lord God, you have promised that the nations will bow before God the Son and that they will testify to his lordship and your love in sending him for the salvation of the world. Thank you that we know your decree to destroy all dominions, authorities, and powers, and to reign until everything is placed under his feet. May the future of Jesus inspire us to pray, to speak, to suffer, and to go out with the gospel for the good of the lost and the life of the world. Please help us to pray, to abide in Christ, and commune with him who goes before us to save the lost through us. Keep us from cowardice because we are weak. Keep us from lethargy because we are dull. And make us prayerful that we might proclaim your love to the perishing. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let your kingdom come. The cross has saved us, so we pray. Father, Lord of heaven and earth, thank you that through the cross, your Son, our Lord, has defeated sin and death by the power of his wrath-bearing sacrifice. Thank you that our guilt has been atoned for, that we are set free to serve you as those made holy to you in Christ. Please help us to know Christ better and trust more deeply in his work, that we might abound in the work of the Lord, knowing that our labor done in him and for him is never in vain. We pray that we would give ourselves fully to work, to labor, to love others, and seek the conversion of the world. Lord, let your kingdom come. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As our Savior taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
We come to a time now where we renew our vision in serving God. And so representatives from the congregation are going to bring three elements, and Rob is going to receive them. We offer ourselves anew into the service of God in this benefice, in this deanery, and across the diocese. The closing words of the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus says, "Go into all the world and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." We pledge ourselves to care for all the people of this benefice, to announce the good news of Jesus Christ, and to invite them into the journey of faith as his disciples. God calls the church in the power of the Holy Spirit to proclaim to people eternal life in Jesus Christ. Our duty and our joy is to share the good news of Christ. People of God, will you be faithful in this Christian calling? We welcome you to continue to share with us in the telling the story of God's love, to baptize new disciples, and to walk with them in the way of Christ. Will you help us to nurture new disciples in the faith and equip them to serve Christ in the world? God forms us in the likeness of his Son, so that we can be his body in the world. Christ calls us to serve the community where we live and work. People of God, will you seek by prayer, by word and action to shape your life according to the example of Jesus, and welcome people of all ages into this family With the help of God, we will. We welcome you to share with us as we seek to make Christ known in fresh ways to new generations in this benefice. Will you help us support all who care for the young, in family schools and in our ministry, as churches teaching the faith and growing disciples of all ages. God calls us to witness to his Son in daily life, seeking his will and living in the power of the Spirit. Christ shares himself with us in word and sacrament, and by these gifts enables us to grow in grace. Our duty and our joy is to share with others in worship and to feed on Christ through the sacrament of his body and blood, faithfully and regularly. People of God, will you do all in your power to deepen your own discipleship and to build the church? With the help of God, we will. Rob, we welcome you to share with us in deepening our partnership in the gospel with all Christian people. Will you nourish our life together through word and sacrament, that we may grow into the full likeness of Christ in hope and love?
Well, congratulations again. Such a delight to be with you all this evening. Thank you for coming. Thank you for joining with us in this act of celebration. Thank you for your prayers and your worship. And please do, particularly if you're perhaps not part of the congregation here, but you're here as a visitor this evening, please do keep praying for Rob and the family and the church here at St. Mary's in these coming weeks and months. After the service, there will be some refreshments available in the hall, so please do stay around and join us for that. Now a prayer of final blessing before we sing our last hymn. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you, those you love and pray for, this day and always. Amen. Your kingdom come.
grace will preach your gospel till our dying breath. Let your kingdom come, let your will be done, so that everyone might know. Everyone might know.